buckle your seatbelts, close the door, grab a drink because Sonny the Songfather Grosso is about to rant. You've been warned, and now, here's Sonny.
Yo! Hello, everybody! It has been a long, long time since I did my podcast. There was a lot going on, obviously, and coming into the holidays and dealing with the health issues, and but everything is looking good so far. I went down to see the boy for a while. I don't even know if I get to talk about that. I think I did. I think I did a COVID concert from down there in Florida and then came up here and delayed with the snowstorm and then very quiet Christmas, you know, first one without Daddy-O and third one without Mom. And so I just, you know, wasn't the same. Went over my sister Gloria's house and we all hung out. We had a good time. But you know, there's an old saying, when the glue of the family goes, everything comes apart at the seams. But we kept it together. And then, you know, heading into January and then a whole bunch of stuff going on and coming up on a one-year anniversary and with the COVID and you couldn't even go to church and couldn't have a, you know, like a little ceremony up in, whatever. Keep on doing what you got to do, you got to do. So got a good report from the oncologist. He actually, Dr. Haas, gave me an A+. An A+, if you can believe that. And all my numbers were good. Blood pressure was perfect. Bingo. Oxygen levels was perfect. Pulse, heartbeat, all that stuff was good. The PSA numbers still continue to come down a little at a time, but it's better than going up. And one of his assistants, and I cannot remember her name because I would give her a gigantic shout out here, went and, you know, took all the vitals and asked all the questions before His Highness came in. And I say that facetiously. That was one of Daddy-O's favorite words, by the way. But because he does not walk around like he's the king, and he is the king when it comes to prostate cancer and the cyberknife. But so I was telling her that I still have, you know, very, very severe burning when I, you know, tinkly-binkly there. And so she goes, all right. And I said, my urologist thinks that there's some damage caused maybe from the radiation. And she said, well, that could be. Some people take longer to heal and whatever. And she was, have you tried cranberry? I said, I can't. I can't drink the stuff. You know, I wish I could, but it just, she goes, no, they have pills. And I said, what? She said, pills. You can get them in a grocery store or any drugstore. And over the counter? She goes, yeah. Yeah. Cranberry pills. All right. I went and looked. I'm on them about 5 weeks now, maybe. Maybe going into the sixth week. I have no idea. Severely improved. Severely is obviously the wrong word, but dramatically, that's the word, dramatically improved. I would have to say, if I'm throwing a number at it, 70% improved with these stupid over-the-counter things. And so I'm going to have to, you know, if anybody out there has extra money, put it aside because I might need bail money because I'm going to have to go beat the crap out of my urologist now. How come he didn't know about this? The pain was unbelievable. I mean, oh my God. If you felt like you had to go, you didn't want to go. It was too scary. Yeah. But so thank God for that. So all those numbers, everything looks pretty good. And he doesn't want to see me for 6 months. They still want me to do the hyperbolic thing, the Michael Jackson glass tube that you sit in. Oh, shit. I was supposed to call them today. I'll call them tomorrow. I think it's an hour and a half or 2 hours. I forget how long it is. And, you know, it's pure oxygen comes in and it helps you healing your body. And I was talking with my CRPS doctor today and he goes, you know, that might help you with the pain and the swelling from the CRPS too. I was like, wow. Hey, everything could be, you know, zippity-doo-dah along the way. So I said, you know what? I was just going to take a nap. Doing a lot of work around here, and I said, I haven't done one of my podcasts. I don't know, it has to be second week in December, maybe, you know? And so I apologize to everybody for that. Yeah, I noticed how much you missed it, people banging on my doors and send me all inboxes, hey, when's your next podcast? Yeah, thanks a lot, pal. But it's good. So I said, the hell with it. Let me just... let me get this one out of the way. And and then, you know, get back into a normal routine, you know. And then next month we got a couple of surprises to lay on you. I got to lay a surprise on you. Anya. I used to know a girl named Anya. Excuse me while I just remember. Do you remember? Well, what do you know? It's my sister Donna's ringtone, The Godfather. We'll just leave it at that. Let me just turn this off. There we go. So, and as fate would have it, for those of you that have been following me along the line, I was cleaning in the bathroom, and I opened the window to get some air in there, you know, because of it's baseboard heating throughout this place. Plus, it's upstairs, you know, in the penthouse down here in beautiful downtown Merrick on the island of Long. And so, you know, it kicks on. It kicks off because it's on two different things. So, you know, like she can't control it from downstairs. I can't control downstairs from my. It's just ridiculous. But, and sometimes it gets a little warm. You know, plus, like I said, being up here and the sun beating down, but definitely not today. But so anyway, I open a window and I look out, and there it is. A beautiful, beautiful cardinal. I'm like, wow, that is something else to see. I'm saying, so I'm just staring at it, you know, kind of daydreaming. I'm saying, I wonder if that's Ma or is that Daddy-O? Bam, another one comes over. Now there's two of them. Not exactly standing next to each other, but close enough to hear each other. That's, you know, they were doing social distancing. That's how I knew it was Ma and Daddy-O. And it was like they came to say hello, and we kind of looked at each other for about 10 seconds, and one went to the left and one went to the right. So I said, oh, that's definitely them. Now they got to go the wrong way. But you could go your own way. You could go your own way. And anyway, so that was cool. You know, I guess they're still around, but I just, when the snow and everything, and we got slammed there. And then the snowstorm from 2 days ago was, I don't know, 4 or 5 inches, not a lot, but it came down very quick, very big flakes, and it turned Merrick. I put some pictures up on Facebook and on Instagram and everything. People couldn't believe that it was Long Island. Like, it wasn't upstate or Vail or Colorado, you know what I mean? It was actually here, just the way it stuck to the trees and the branches and everything. That's the kind of snowstorms that I like. You know, I ain't happy when it crashes into the teens afterwards, because then it doesn't go away. But so, you know, another one coming, supposedly coming today, but they make me nervous when they say anywhere from a coating to an inch. Unless, once I hear unless, I want to go punch their face out. And especially, you know who, on that channel, the Long Island channel. They have to listen to this guy talk about nothing, talk about shit every 12 minutes. And I swear, when there's a storm in the area, they put him on like every 5 minutes. And it just, he is just so freaking annoying. Anyway, so some storms coming today, then another one's coming Thursday, then another one's coming Sunday, you know, but don't worry about it. It's only going to be a couple here and there. I wait for Samantha Gary. She comes on, I think, at 3 o'clock. She is on the money all the time. She's, you know, she's not glued to the freaking computers. What a computer said is she puts her own opinion out there. Plus, the kid on the weekend, too, he's the same way. All right. The computers are saying for this, but I don't think so. I think it's going to do this. Boom. Great, great. That, you're fun to watch. You're not acting like a know-it-all, you know, going off the computers. Anyway, there's my rant. It's been building up for a long time. So, for the longest time. So, if anybody watched the Super Bowl, I cannot believe, you know, I am always, my life been always rooted for the underdog, but I never disrespected, as you know, the big phrase now for the past few years is GOAT. And I've never disrespected GOATs, you know, unless they're a, you know, piece of craps and arrogant human beings, and I never. And so people were asking me, like, so who do you like in the Super Bowl? I said, well, you know what, Kansas City, is a good team. It's a tough team. People were picking them from day one. I hadn't watched football all year long because of everything that they did there. But, you know, come the big day, what the hell? And but I said, I got to go with Brady. You know, I mean, he's 43 years old. And in world, it's not an old person. In business, you're getting to be an old person. But in football, you're ancient. You can't be playing football at 43. Get out of here. He looked like he was 20-something years old. Sharp, crisp. He knew what he was doing. He knew what he was calling. He took his lumps when it got handed to him. But that defense stepped right up for him. And beautiful, 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 beautiful job that he did. 7 rings now. He definitely is the GOAT. 7 rings. That is like unbelievable. And then there's a meme going around on social media of course, I'm going to laugh at it because I love the Yankees, of Yogi Berra with all his rings on. He's got 12. Oh, so the kid's got his 7th ring, huh? Oh, that's cute. But, yeah, oh, my God, 7 rings and I think, I don't know, something like 15 times to the Super Bowl. I mean, there's nobody at all, anywhere, going to come close to that record. And you don't even know if he's done yet. You know, just happy to see Gronk get in there and get a couple of, you know, JPP, missed him. The Giants let him go, you know, because he blew 2 fingers off. Hey, what's wrong with you? And, but, you know, he had a great year, of course, but he had a great playoff, all the games and in there and sacks and tackles. And, I mean, he was just a man on a mission. And he got his ring. He's only got... He's only got 8 fingers to put the ring on, so he could still get one more than Brady did. But you know what? After they won the game to go into the Super Bowl, you know, everybody and their mother's waiting to talk to this guy. Excuse me. He goes all the way over, jumps up on the little top thing there and calls his son over and gives him a hug. How do you like that? How do you like that? He says to his son. That's great, Dad. I'm so proud of you, Dad. How do you make fun of a guy like that? What is wrong with these people? Crapping and shitting all over them. Oh, they cheated. Again, they're starting with the refs were on his side. Oh, my God, stop. A nice guy. You know, Mahomes, too. You know, you can get a little cocky like they all can, but as a player, as a leader, as a human being, he's a class act, too, and he's got a long career ahead of him. And if he was looking from the sidelines at that 43-year-old man that was on the field, I hope he was looking at himself saying, wait a minute. I could do that too, you know. Just make sure you got a line, protect yourself. But there is no doubt about it that Brady is a GOAT, but he's also a leader, and he gets. He's like he reminds me of Dan Marino. That he gets that. You know, he's not just buying the Isotoner gloves. And for those of you that don't know what I just said, go back to bed. You're too young. But Marino used to do that too. You know, no matter who they gave him, who they traded for, whatever they did, put somebody on that offensive line, it didn't take more than a month of the preseason to get them to understand their job and protect him at all costs. And that's why Marino was able to throw up as many numbers as he did, because he had a line to protect him. A quarterback is only as good as the people that had given him time to be good. So it wasn't just, and he said that, and he always said that. It wasn't just... you know, Brady that won the Super Bowl for Tampa Bay. It was the whole team. It was the whole offensive line. It was the defense. It was the, you know, the guys in the ends running their patterns and boom. And listen, go 12 out and bang left and quick right. And when you turn, the ball's going to be there. Okay? You turned. The ball was there. You caught it. That's how it's done. So, you know. Not like poor Mahomes. He's hitting guys and it's bouncing off their helmets left and right. I mean, crazy. But anyway, so now that's done. And baseball is supposed to be starting up soon. But now everybody's up in arms, and everybody that was at the I guess she's the mayor of Tampa Bay put out a thing that she's going to have all the police department and whatever investigators they can gather up come and watch the tape and watch everybody coming in, and they're going to find out what is wrong. We're going to find out who they were out there that didn't have their masks on, and we're going to arrest them. What? You're going to tie up the Tampa Bay Police Department and detectives and extra investigators to go through all the tape and all the different cameras so you could try to identify who was sitting in the stands without their mask on? Then why'd you even let them in? What did you think was going to happen, you freaking moron? You know, oh, well, you know, most of them were all from the medical field, and that was our way of saying, I don't care where they were from. You're putting them into the stadium to watch the World Series, listen to me, to watch the Super Bowl. So they file in, they do what they got to do, everybody behave themselves except that one asshole that ran onto the field, figuring he wasn't going to be able to get tackled because nobody was going to touch him with the COVID. And those two cops that ended up finally getting him, I mean, they were flying through the air like Superman. But it's done. It's over. Now they're saying, you wait and see what's going to happen now. This is bad. It's going to be terrible. The COVID the numbers are going to spike now because of these people, 12,000, whatever they allowed into the stadium. It's going to spike now because they let them in and sitting so close to each other, they should have spread them out more and blah, 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 blah. I don't know. But anyway, so now let's see what happens. You know, DeBozo and DeFuhrer decided here in New York that they were going to allow inside dining back, but they were waiting till Valentine's Day. You know, that was the little bone they were going to throw to restaurants and the people. And restaurant associations and other people said, well, you know what? If we're not allowed to go in and start getting everything ready, how are we going to be ready for 14th? He said, yeah, you know what? That's a good point. So he loosened the belt. Those are his words, not mine. And they can open Friday instead of Sunday. What a freaking jerk. But if the numbers go up, I'm closing all the restaurants down again. Then you know what? Then don't. Don't even open them. Don't put these poor people through this again. You know, I mean, a couple of very good friends of mine lost their restaurant. Borelli's out here on Long Island over here in East Meadow. Been going there, you know, since the 60s. Friends with the family, hung out with the family and everything else. And they almost lost their business. But I have so many friends, especially in the city, gone. Restaurant is gone, done. Even the famous Patsy's went and bought a place over in Jersey, and it was going to run the two of them. He said, you know what? Depending how this goes, I'm getting the hell out of the city. It's shit. New York City is not New York City anymore. I don't even know where it is. You can close down. Patsy's been there for 125 years. Rayo's is debating what they're going to do. You know, or they're toying with the idea of maybe opening up Broadway to one or two shows and see how it goes. But stop. Make your decision. It is good. It isn't good. Now they're saying, isn't it funny how they're saying now that they did some investigating, and it looks like the coronavirus got spread around the world from animals and not from China. Isn't that funny? Since Mr. Biden loves China. Come on, man! So freaking ridiculous. You know? The last time, I think it was in 2007, 10, somewhere around there. But there was another coronavirus. I don't know what number it was. That was spreading all around the world. And it came out of Wuhan. And it came out of that laboratory. Everything was the same, the way it spread and everything else. Boom. This happens, same thing. Same lab. It's happened three times out of the same lab. Now, all of a sudden, because Donald Trump is out, and Biden and all the cronies, you know, that love China and you know, whatever. I'm not gonna say things that I don't know to be true 100%. But you know, I'm very intuitive. I've been told my life. But now all of a sudden, no, it didn't happen in China. No, it happened from animals. Animals. They had their own lab somewhere. Where in Africa or whatever. That'll be the next thing. He hates black people anyway. And that is on record many times out of his own mouth. And so, yeah, let's blame it on Africa. We need China. We need that. We need their business. We need to open up trade with them again. We need the money. We need this. And now we're borrowing money from China. Half the world owes us money here in the United States, China being one of them. And but now we're going to go and borrow a lot of money. We need it. We need to borrow money from China. Of all places, we need to borrow. It's not bad enough that they've already bought up half the country, and they're looking to buy up more in businesses and everything. It makes no sense. Or does it? Or maybe it does. Whatever. So isn't it good? Isn't it good to have my rant back? I know you like it. Can you dig it? I knew that you could. Of course. That was so funny. Yeah, thank you. So, WBXO is in the process, but everything gets knocked down again, is in the process of, switching studios, and Gene Garns, the commander-in-chief, is selling the house, but they moved all the equipment, and they got a new computer, and this and that, and blah, blah, blah. So we're going to get ready, and we're going to start, doing the shows again, and everybody who's been on a hiatus, and blah, 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 boom. Two people come down with COVID. We haven't even been in the studio. And two people came down with COVID. There's a place out here in Comac. It's a chain, but I don't know exactly where they all are, but called Hobby Lobby. And in the last month to 5 weeks, don't hold me to the exact number, but it's between 12 and 15 employees, which are mostly kids. When I say kids, 18 to 25. Those are kids. And then a couple of adults have all come down with COVID. They're still in business. Not that I want them to go out of business, but you think the Starbucks down the road had 5 people over the course of 2 months come down with COVID. They shut the place down for 10 days, completely scrubbed it down, cleaned it, Lysoled it, whatever the frig they got to do to make sure that there's nothing living anywhere inside their thing. Here, in 5 weeks, they've had like 15 employees, just employees. We don't know about the customers that are coming in and out. 15 employees came down with COVID, and you didn't even close it down for a day to find out what's going on. Clean everything down. Is it coming, from the trucking? Is it coming from here? Is it where? What's going on? Nothing. I understand the need for business and all that, but if it is that dangerous, as they say it is, which I believe it is, if you have a healthy body and you get it, I think you'll be okay. But you still got to go through it. You still got to go through the 2-week quarantine. You might not have to be hospitalized, but. If you have any underlying conditions, if you're a diabetic, if you're fighting cancer, if you have pulmonary issues and everything else, it could be a very serious to life-ending kind of a thing. Here you have 15 people in 5 weeks, and you don't do anything about it. Business as usual. That's wrong. So I promised I wouldn't say anything. Whoops! Sorry. What did I say? Oh, yes, it's in Comac. It's called the Hobby Lobby. Check it out. I was going to send it to my friends over at News 12. We got a bunch of friends that work there. And I said, nah, that's being a rat. Ranting and just, bumbling at the mouth like I just did now, and it slipped out. That's a different story. But anyway, so down the road, I don't know how much longer, wait till everybody is better and healed and get all the shows running back on WBXO. And reminded me how much I missed playing that music too, and then I want to get back on track with the COVID concerts. We're at, I think the last one I did was number 55, so that's not too bad, But then maybe start putting up one of those Venmos or whatever the frig they call it, I don't know. And people want to leave a tip, part of it for me, and I'll pick up like a charity maybe every month. If I do 4 COVIDs a month, one a week, one of those weeks I'll do it for charity, for the veterans, the disabled veterans, and do one for St. Jude's and do another one for the Shriners. And yeah, there's just so many people out there that need help, homeless people, everything else. And anyway, so I'm looking around. What am I going to play? And I got to play this one. I always loved Crimson and Crover, but Crover, what am I, Chinese? Oh, I said Chinese. What the heck is wrong with me? I cracked myself up. But anyway, this is the version by Joan Jett, and I thought she really did a great job at it. Enjoy. Enjoy. I'll be back. Walking over.
Now I've been waiting to
show her.
Crimson and clover. Over and over.
Yeah, Joan. Hey. Man, such a sweet day.
Really? Woo!
Take it, Joan. Take it.
Superpower. They can help save lives by not having play dates. That's right. By replacing get-togethers with virtual play dates and video chats, they can help slow the evil spread of germs. And if your superheroes do go outside, make sure they continue their superhero wing by staying 6 feet away from others to protect everyone in America land. Find out more at coronavirus.gov. A message from the CDC and the Ad Council.
And the Ad Council, that's correct. Can't forget it. Still got to keep doing what we're doing. And you know, there's talk of mandatory face masks 24 hours a day. But now they're backing away from it. You don't hear about it anymore. You don't see Cuomo with his daily conferences and DeBozo in the city, and even Murphy over in Jersey. It's not like a big thing anymore. You know, even Fauci's backing off. You know, but they're also saying, I mean, maybe, you know, and maybe you should wear it in the car too, and you should wear it at all times, and this and that. But they never talk about gloves. You don't talk about gloves anymore. Why not? Why wouldn't you talk about gloves? You see all these news stations doing remotes and of different places that are getting ready to open, and so, you know, that have been open. You're only for curbside and whatever. It's, at least here on the island, in the city, you can't even do that. But so there they are in there, and they got their masks on, and they're cooking and this and that, and showing you how to make this and make that, and they have no gloves on. Yeah. First it lived on wood, then it didn't. Then it lived longer when it was on metal than it wasn't. Then it was floating in the air. Now it's not, you know. That's why I got to stay 6 feet apart. And then people still don't understand. You don't have to do 6 feet apart if you have the masks on. The 6 feet apart was for if you don't have a mask on, then you have to stay 6 feet apart. If you have a mask on, you don't have to. Then you see the news people that are out there. And they got the microphones at the end of a wouldn't touch you with a 10-foot pole. You see them out there with 10-foot poles interviewing the people, but they have their masks on. You don't have to do that. It's not their fault. It's not the people's fault. It's all the directions that are coming from all the so-called, you know, geniuses and the people that know what's the right thing to do and the right way to do it. It's not coming out that way. They have no clue. You know, now, another one, the one that came out of nowhere from Africa. That's the one. That's the dangerous one now. Oh, why is that dangerous? How come all of a sudden? You know, there's an extra, so, you know, it's just so stupid. So I don't know if anybody saw it. It was taken down almost as quick as it was spreading around the world. But where they were getting a room ready for some kind of a Senate hearing or Senate meeting. I don't know what the hell it was. But the mic was on. It was a hot mic. And these two guys are there. I don't know if they were assemblymen or senators. I don't remember who they were. But they're talking. And one says to the other that they just, did you see the new COVID numbers? The infection rate is 0.1 to 0.3%. And the other guy goes, where'd you hear that? He goes, they just came out with it this morning. He goes, oh, no, I didn't see that. He goes, yeah, 0.1 to 0.3. And then the other guy goes, so it's right in line with the flu. And then the other guy says back, absolutely, 100%. It's got the same infection rate and, seriousness rate and death rate, whatever the hell it is, as the regular flu. And then the other guy says, they don't know the mic is hot. So it was a hoax after all. And then the other guy did poop on his pants and went, I wouldn't say it was a hoax, but certainly not as serious as they were making it out to be. Boom. It starts to fly all over the world. Bet now it's gone. You can't find it anyway. You know, and you can't fire these guys, obviously, because they're voted in. But what the hell? You know, and then you got Ocasio here, the lunatic bartender, although she is hot, but from here, from New York, you know, playing like what's his name was on, I can't remember his name now, too, the reporter on Channel 4, you know, that said he was, doing a remote from Afghanistan and bombs were going off around him. And turned out he was lying. He wasn't even there. And, you know, everybody jumped all over Trump. He was an animal. He was this. He was rude. He was obnoxious. You know, they say everything, but he was right about the fake news. How many times was CNN caught with fake news and fake field reporting and this and that and blah, blah, blah. So she's saying now, she comes out and, you know, she was sitting there in her office and she was scared. And all of a sudden she heard the banging on the wall, very violent banging. And she thought she was going to be killed and she wasn't even there. I mean, come on. If anything, you don't want to give him credit for anything, then don't. I mean, no wars in 4 years. He's been nominated 4 or 5 times for the Nobel Peace Prize. You know, he has Palestinians and Egyptians and Israel all sitting down at a table. And, you know, he's got Kwon Wong Hang Ging Day over there in North Korea, shut his mouth and sat down. You haven't heard from him in 3 years. Now, all of a sudden, he's starting warships. He's starting nuclear testing again. That's it. Everybody's going out of their mind. France, everybody was jumping all over him for Trump for beating up France and making fun of France and saying that they're all full of shit and blah, 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 blah. And now the reports come out, and France, who's the one that, you know, was doing this whole thing with the climate warming or whatever the hell they call it, failed. They didn't do what they were supposed to be doing. Nobody says a word. Report comes out, and that's it. Nobody speaks about it. Nobody's, whatever. But anyway, so, you know, it's so out of control where we're going to go. I have no idea. I don't know. But to give them 2 days is kind of ridiculous. You know, you're just giving them for Valentine's Day. Give them a week. All right, listen, we were going to go with the 14th and let everybody go up. You know, they went up 10% in Jersey. Murphy says, well, instead of having 25%, you can have 35%. Yeah, okay. You know, and I still don't get that. I went out to dinner in Manhattan, in the city, on Saturday, and you can't eat inside. So everybody was sitting outside, you know, which is inside, because it's inside a tent, you know. No windows, glass. I mean, you know, plastic, you could see out what's going on, but you're inside. You're inside a tent, which is the same thing as being inside a restaurant, which I don't understand. But anyway, it was cold. It was definitely cold out there. And you stand there, you got to wait, you come up the steps, and you got to wait until the table's opened. And all right, yeah, come on in, not taking reservations, blah, blah, blah. All right, good, whatever. And then still the same thing. Put your mask on, walk past two tables, and take your mask off. And then you sit down and you eat and you talk, and everybody around you, everybody at the tables around you, are they 6 feet away? Yeah. Yeah, they are. But nobody has a mask on, except the servers. But nobody has a mask on. That's the other thing, too. The servers are there, and they got the mask on, but they don't have gloves on. They're touching the food. They're touching the plates. They're bringing you dessert. They're bringing you drinks, whatever. Put gloves on. But anyway, so... Then when you get up to leave, then you got to put your mask on, and you walk past two more tables, then you take your mask off again. I don't know. It makes no sense to me. But anyway, that was Joan Jett singing Crimson and Clover. And I like the way she did it. I liked her version. And of course, you got to like Joan Jett. How could you not like Joan Jett? What are you, nuts? I guess all I got to learn to do is what the Beatles always say. Just let it be. That's what we all got to learn to do. Let it be. Take it.
When I find myself in times of trouble, Mother Mary comes to me.
That's right.
Speaking words of wisdom.
Let it be.
And in my
hour of darkness. Right in front of me.
Speaking words of wisdom.
Let it be.
Let it be.
Let it be. Let it be. Yeah, let it be.
Whisper
words of wisdom. Let it be.
And when the broken hearted
people
living in
the world agree.
Answer,
let it be. Ba bum ba bum.
But though they may be parted, there is still a chance
that they will see.
There will be an answer.
Let it be.
Let it be. Let it be.
Woo!
Let it be.
Yeah, let it be.
Yeah, there
will be answer.
Let it be.
Yeah, let it be.
Whisper
words of wisdom. Let it be. Damn, I'm good. Take it, boys. Bow, 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 bow. Let it be, let it be, let it be, yeah, let it be. Words of wisdom, let it be.
And when the night is cloudy, there is still light.
Depends on me, shine on to tomorrow. Let it be.
I wake up to the
sound of music. Mother Mary comes to me,
speaking words of wisdom.
Let it be.
Let it be. Let it be. Let it be.
Yeah, let it be. Will be an answer. Let it be.
Let it be. Let it be. Let it be. Yeah, let it be. There will be an answer. Let it be.
Woo!
Let it be. Let it be. Let it be. Yeah, let it be. Whisper words of wisdom. Let it be.
That's right. Yeah. Beautiful. Let It Be from the Let It Be album. Anyway, so where we are here? Oh, we got 42 minutes into the show. Getting ready to start wrapping things up. Like to keep it under between 45 and an hour. And then we'll see down the road, you know. I got a good friend, my good friend, Mr. Joe Piscopo, who loved my daddy-o. And I don't know how he does it. And I don't know how Imus did it. And I don't know how Howard Stern does two shows a day. And you know, he's on two, even three, on three different stations on what's it, VH1, my God, on Sirius XM. I don't know. I don't know how Joe does it. Joe gets up and every day, 4 o'clock in the morning, and goes in and does a four-hour show. Good for you, Joe. Maybe it's because I'm home here. I don't know. But once I start having guests, I'm waiting for one more piece of equipment, and then I'll be able to do it remotely with a lot of people in the industry, out of the industry, people I grew up with, friends. I keep telling you about Dom Fratto. The man knows the most ridiculous things about music. Some of them, like, unbelievably obscure, and some of them, you know, something we should all know, but he knows everything, you know. And he'll be able to call in, and then we'll make it, you know, a little more interactive. I mean, you know, thank God I play a couple of songs here. Then they try to get me in trouble for, oh, you shouldn't play that song, you don't have the right to play that. Stop. There is no money changing hands here. I am not charging people to listen, and I am not getting money from people that are listening. It's just entertainment. What the frig is? Are you crazy? Am I going to do something that's going to hurt the Beatles? Am I going to do something that's going to allow Joan Jett never to play another song again? What? You know, come on. You're taking things too far. Too far. And that's the problem. You know, I used to say that was always the big thing with politics. We can't stop the drug trade, so let's go after red light breakers. You know, it's so stupid. It's copyright infringement. It is and it isn't. You understand? It's free publicity for the song, first of all. But if I am not charging an admission to come in, if I am not earning a living off what you created, then I'm not violating anything. I'm just playing a song that I like to hear, that I'm sure a lot of other people like to hear. Stop, please. Stop. Don't make me angry. You wouldn't like me when I'm angry. I like saying that. It was on a commercial. I think it was on the Superbowl. Using that line from the Hulk, you know, Bill Bixby. It was one of my favorite lines, you know. Because you know what could happen, you know. You're like, don't make me angry. You wouldn't like me if I'm angry.
because I'll be ripping my shirt off and destroying everything in sight. Yeah. Hey, you want to close that door over there, please? Thank you. Yeah, good. Thank you, stupid ass son of a... Anyway, so finishing up for the rest of the week with the snow. They're saying maybe 4 inches total between these three storms. So, okay. So today the snowstorm is supposed to be starting sometime in the late afternoon. And they had people out doing remotes, okay, driving, just like they were doing the other day. But driving down a road that's been plowed, that there is not a flake, a patch of ice, there is nothing on the road, beautiful. Cars are going by doing 50, 60, 65 miles an hour. And here's the reporters. And here we are. Yes, we're traveling out here now. And, you know, we're just, so far things look nice and calm. We, you know, we got the storm coming this afternoon. We have a storm coming this afternoon where everybody and their mother said, according to maybe an inch. What are you doing remotes out there in the weathermobile? I mean, is life that bad? You don't think there's enough news? Here's an idea. Why don't you do some happy stories? Not just, it's little Tommy's 9th birthday today. That's nice. Happy birthday, Tommy. Yeah, it's great. How about instead of seeing this weather guy every 8 minutes, how about he does one at the top of the hour, one at halfway through the hour, and then he comes back again? Unless something happens and he's got to come in, and you don't need to see him. You don't need to see him every 8 minutes, every 12 minutes. You don't need that. How about filling that time up with some happy stories, some good stories? Let everybody start sending them in, like I used to do on my Facebook show every night. You know, thanks to Chrissy. Chrissy used to go, you know, all the stories that you're telling, I understand it, and I understand your thinking behind it, but it's depressing. Can't you do some good news stories? And that's what I did. And I changed it all to Chrissy's Good News of the Day or whatever the heck it was. And you put 4 or 5 stories in there, lifts everybody's spirits up, and it even teaches them a little bit of what they could do, what we all could do in this world out there. But, you know, to put somebody out on a remote report about weather that's not existing right now, and it's really not supposed to exist. You know, even during the snowstorm, they had people every 7 minutes, whatever the frig it was, going out. And we got Sonny Grosso out here. He's on Old Country Road. And how's it going out there? Well, you know, as you can see, it's coming down like crazy, and it's very dangerous out there. And behind me, if I'm the reporter, the cars are flying by. And you look, and you can see there's nothing on the road. Now, the side streets in the big storm that we got, okay, that's a different one. I'm talking about the one that just hit. So when it came down for that quick couple of hours and the big giant flakes and covered everything, yeah, it covered the roads and it covered the side streets and everything. It didn't cover the main streets at all. But it was all gone within 2 hours. You know, it stayed up on the trees and everything, which was great. It was 34 degrees. At one point, it was still snowing at 37 degrees. So you know it's not going to be around. Why make it a disaster? Why make it a potential disaster when it's not going to be one? Why get everybody nuts? Unless the grocery stores are paying your money to do it. I don't know. Which I always said. Even when I spent my 30 years with A&B and Wallbaum's and Old Dominion or New Dominion up in Canada and Kohl's. And I mean, I used to go all over the United States for the company. And, you know, yeah, business sales are really down. I don't know what's going on. You know, we need, I mean, this would be in boardroom meetings. We need a good snowstorm. Why don't you lower your goddamn prices? How about that? Maybe that'll help. Anyway, so where are we? Yeah, right. We're at the 49-minute mark, and we'll go out with Little Tull. One of my favorites from them. Of course, Wind Up is definitely number one. I always like Aqualung, and I did like Mother Goose. I got to be honest, you know. But the Hymn 43, just it's a good song. You know, Wind Up, you know I love Wind Up, and you know the reasons why. Don't you know the reason why? The whole song is predicated on the fact that so many phonies out there that only come to church you know, on the holidays, the high holy days, not even the days of obligation, just, you know, New Year's and Christmas and Thanksgiving, maybe, you know, and Easter. And or the ones that go out and do crap all week long and then get all dressed up and go to church and, you know, act like they're doing the right thing. And that's what the song is about. Not this one. Kind of close with Hymn 43. It's a little bit of a harsher, attitude towards it. But in Wind Up, he's saying, you know, hey, he's not the kind of guy you have to wind up every Sunday. Live that way. Live that way 6 days a week and stay home on Sunday and relax. You know, stay home with your family. Have a little something to eat. You know, shoot the shit across the table. What's going on in your life? Who, you know, who are your friends? Who are you hanging out with? This and that, blah, blah, blah. Makes sense to me. And that's song from early 70s. And, you know, what have we learned since then? What have we learned in over 2,000 years? Obviously nothing. Or not as much as we should, you know. But anyway, so this is Hymn number 43 by Jethro Tull. And I'll be doing my next podcast in another day or so. And then we'll get back into a regular kind of routine. So, all right. I love you all. Thanks for tuning in. Tell everybody about it. Tell everybody. We got to hear this guy. This guy's Sonny. Oh, my God. He's got a podcast. He sings. He does these dances. He draws. He writes children's books. He does a thought for the day. He does everything. He used to be a Chippendale dancer, but he couldn't walk with all the quarters in his underwear.
Yeah.
Was busy with his
money man.
His women and his guns.
Yeah. Song of hero. He killed an Indian all three, yeah. And he made his name in Hollywood to set the white man free. Oh, Jesus, save me. Jesus saved. Well, he better save himself from the glory seekers who use his name in death. Oh, Jesus, save me. He's a saint. Better save himself from the glory seekers who use his name in death. Oh, Jesus, save me. I'm in the city and on the mountains of the moon, yeah. His cross was rather bloody. He could hardly roll a stone. Big ending now. Here we go. Yeah,
Jethro Tull, hymn number 43. Let's have a nice hand for the song, Father. Thank you. Thank you very much. Thank you. Let's hear from the chicks out there. Ah, thank you. Very good. Okay, everybody, have a good day. Have a good night. Be safe. Follow the rules, break a few, and help everybody out there that needs some help. You know, the homeless and the disabled and the shut-ins and the elderly and people that are out of work, looking for work. You know, nobody wants to do this anymore. Nobody wants to do the unemployment and wait until the idiots that are going to give us a $2,000 stimulus check and then raise our taxes and our gases and everything else. In the last month, the gas went from 140. Let's go back a little bit further than that. Okay, 140, I'm sorry. It went from one, out here on the island of Long anyway. It was down at to 197, then it went to 203, then it went to 215. But I got gas yesterday, it was 251. All of a sudden. But shut the pipeline down. Lay off 40,000 people. This pray. Pray, everybody. Pray. And all right, I got to do it. Please don't be mad. All right, everybody. Love you. Take care.